What he's stressing to them is that it's not about the outward expression of some literature kind of a poetic theatrical presentation. Aren't you tired of the theater in the church? Aren't you tired of the politics and the kind of you gotta look a certain way and you gotta talk a certain way? Well, you know, praise the Lord. I introduced somebody some years ago to the bank president in Longview. The bank president, the president of the bank. We trying to get some money to build a church. And I introduced her and said, now this is my head deacon and this is the bank president. Oh, glory. Oh, man, can you just stand up? I mean, don't forget me. Hold the tongues till later. Speak in tongues after we get the money. I mean, just don't fall out for the bank president to wonder who is he dealing with. Lord help us. You meet people on the bus and just be who you are. You don't have to say, verily, verily, I say unto you, and oh, can we rebuke folk? And rebuking a lot of folk don't make you sanctified. It's just you using the name of God to hurt somebody else's feelings. That's all that is. Where is that quiet power? That individual who moves in the house don't have to say a word, but you feel something vibrating inside the spirit of the individual. Where is that person who doesn't wear a halo but has a halo in their spirit? So a sweet spirit comes over that you know this person has been with God. We got so many humble, proud folk, you know, that just brag about how humble they are. You ain't got to brag about your humility. Just roll up your sleeve and bless somebody, and then we'll know that God is moving in your life. And so what he endeavored to prove is that the more controls within, the better the defense for the struggle that's without. And I hear him clearly when he establishes the principles that connects the minds to the things of God. And what Paul says is that's all fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. And in order then to grasp this, you've got to know then that he is the substratum of the universe. And not only is he the substratum of the universe, but he is the substratum of the individual soul. And there are three principles that connect you to him: faith, hope, and charity. If you step in this house and declare that you are a child of God, then you've got three significant weapons, and one is faith. And faith is the hypostasis of things not seen, the elikos of which the thing would come clearly. It is the substance of things hoped for. It is the elikos of things not seen. Anybody that is a child of God operates in faith. And that is, no matter what my circumstances are, I believe God. I feel something pushing me now. And that is, I believe God who I don't see, above and beyond the circumstances that I do see. Because the only reason I can make it through the present is because I have expectations for the future. And I don't live in the past. I feel something happening here. Don't bring up my past. There are some things and that I can't change, and some things that I can't fix. I don't need faith for the past. I need faith for the future. I can document my path, but I believe in the future, that no matter matter how rough my history is, in Jesus Christ, my future has now been changed. I don't know where I'm coming from. I really don't care now. I only know that I'm going somewhere in Jesus Christ. I feel something happening here already. These three ingredients connect us to God with the proper attitude towards life. I don't give up when I have faith, and I don't give up when I have hope, and I express my faith and my hope through the cycle of love, because it's the love of God that gives me hope, and it is the love of God that gives me faith, because I can trust in a God who loves me. Can I preach like I feel it? There is no greater single emotion that can stabilize the mind than to know you are loved, and particularly to know you were loved by someone who has the power to express that love in any and all circumstances. I don't need this for this. I can preach this without my notes. There is love that can only go so far. It's not that I don't love you. It's that I'm loving you out of contaminated containers. It's not that I don't love you, but I can only love you out of the purity of who I am, and I ain't that pure. So my love has the taint of the weakness of my humanity. So when I tell you I love you, I'm actually saying to you that I can only love you within the parameters of my capacity to love you. And understand, when I say I love you, that it is limited. I wish I could talk to those of us who have been married and divorced, who got up in front of the preacher, in front of God, and all these witnesses, and said, together forever, for better and for worse. Somehow it wasn't better that got you a divorce. It seems to me that it was worse that got you a divorce. But you went in the house in love. But your love couldn't handle the worst. I wish I'm talking to somebody. I didn't mean for you to go nostalgic and decide to bury your head in the sand, because I'm divorced too, if you recall. The truth is that love had its limits. Your love had its limits. So while you're in love, you're still keeping some secrets just in case the lover can't handle your secrets, because you're saying to yourself that maybe their love can't go as far as all of my secrets. And I'm not just talking about the secrets you brought in, I'm talking about the secrets you made since you got in. All right, y'all don't want to deal with me, but I'm gonna preach it anyhow. The truth is that love has its limits, yours does. But isn't it marvelous to bask in the sunshine of a love that has no limits, and a love that already knew who you were when he signed up to take you on? I wish I could understand. Because once I have that love, I can have faith in that love, that whatever he said he would do, I can't even stop him from doing it. I can stop you from staying with me, but I can't stop him from staying with me, because he already told me coming in, I will never leave you. I wish I could talk to you here. I feel like lifting him up. I told somebody the other day, I don't know how long it was, but I told somebody, I told them, now you got to decide whether you gonna stay with me or not. You got to decide, because I ain't gonna leave you. Can I preach like I feel that? I don't know, have you ever told anybody that, but I did. I said, I'm not gonna leave you. And maybe I said it because I'm the problem. You know how that works. I'm not gonna leave you. So if we gonna break up, you gonna have to leave me, because I ain't gonna leave you. I feel like preaching in here. And I think I heard God say it to me. And that is, if we gonna break up, you gonna have to leave me, because I already told you coming in, I will never leave you nor forsake you. And it's not because I don't know your weakness, it's because I know my strengths. I wish I could bring somebody in this house. I'm not leaving you because of your weakness. I'm staying with you because of my strength. And my strength is made perfect in weakness. If you want to see how much I love you, show me how weak you can be. I feel like lifting him up. Y'all excuse me, I'm going. Touch your neighbor and say, neighbor, I'm going somewhere. This is the power then of Jesus, because once he emits that kind of love, he becomes now the hope. I feel it in here. He becomes the hope of glory. You're not the hope of glory. He is the hope of glory. But he just chooses for the hope of glory to be in you. Can I see that, or did I read it wrong? Because he says, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you. Oh God, I feel it. Somebody say, in me. Hit yourself on the chest and say, in me. It's the hope of glory. Can I get some help over here? It's a process. You're not going to get there overnight. But realize, with everything you're going through, that you're going somewhere. Because the operative term here is going through. And in order to make you what he wants you to be, he's got an ultimate place that you are going to be. Now, for the last 25 years, we have thought that a relationship with God, especially Americans, is wrapped up in how much we have financially. But I've come to tell you that God is not at all concerned a great deal about your financial position. He already told you early in your relationship that I know what you have need of before you ask. He says, ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. And he even chided us when he said, who among you can add a statue to your, a cubit to your statue by sitting around worrying every day? You worrying about money, I got that. But what you ought to worry about is being conformed into the image of my son. I'm going somewhere.